not in any trouble. 15 seconds on his final lap.
Here comes Dallas.
A world champion has just been crowned. This is a title that any driver from any motorsport wants. The world of RC is no different. Both teams and individuals started working on winning these worlds as soon as the last worlds were over, 2 years ago. The 2014 season was largely dominated by Ty Tessman. The Messina Worlds were no exception. Ty went in ranked as the number one driver, and it was really his race to lose.
We get here, and from start to finish, you pretty much own the race. Yeah, it's unbelievable.
While it was a triumph for Ty, not everyone left Italy with fond memories.
I can't really, you know, I don't know what else to say. We were there and thereabouts, and we could have probably contended for the win. They didn't want me to do it this week, so we'll do it in 2 years. In Vegas. And if we don't do it, at least we can have a really good night out.
But it's just the way it goes, I guess.
Vegas, baby.
Yep, 2016, here we come.
Well, yeah, it's Vegas. Better place to win, I think.
Yeah.
So 2 years prep, and then I'll be back to win.
But what does 2 years prep look like? It usually starts with the Nitro Challenge, which is to RC like Anaheim 1 is to Supercross. Further, it is one of the largest and most prestigious Nitro races in the world. Ty, now the incumbent world champion, would suffer a freak accident. His receiver plug would come undone. At this level, there is no way to recover, and hometown hero Ryan Mayfield would take the win. Poor results would follow Ty to the Silver State race. Jared would win this weekend, followed by Ryan Cavallari the very next weekend at the Neo race. While Elliott Boots was kept off the podium at the Neo race, he would take a huge milestone win at the Euros. At the U.S. version of this race, the Roar Nationals, Ty would turn his season around slightly. He put in a dominating performance, lapping the entire field and handily taking the win. What would be in store for Ty and the rest of this traveling circus in 2016? For most racers here in America, a domestic world will only happen once in their career. The importance of this event is evident in virtually all of the top drivers' racing programs. Preparations for this event start very early on in the season.
Pretty much any time I have, a day or two here or there, and the weather's good, I'm going to try to make it out there. If there's a bunch of races going on, or like this weekend, for example, I'm going to Arizona for a race, I may not run quite as much during the week, maybe just one day. But normally I try to run 2 days during the week, and then usually at least one day on the weekend, unless there's a race or something else going on.
Adam Drake, fan favorite and seasoned veteran of the traveling circus that is professional RC racing, is no different. At his home track of Revelation Raceway, Adam is testing.
More than anything is just trying to, not overthink things, just treat it like another race. I think that's the hardest thing is, you try to put that little bit of extra effort in, and sometimes you can kind of, drive yourself crazy.
Very few in this industry match Adam's dedication to preparedness. But will his efforts pay off, or will he be shut out of the main final for a second Worlds in a row? The storied Silver State race is once again being held at its new home, the C tracks of Las Vegas. Thanks to a dust inhibitor known as FSB 1000, the track would be smooth, dry, and the grip levels are through the roof. While it was consistent, the racers are not huge fans of the surface. It's nearly the opposite of last year's race.
For me, I would rather see a more natural surface, let the track get bumpy. You have to change up your lines and kind of, you know, man up through the bumps and let it hang out a little bit. But at the end of the day, it's the same for all of us. So, you know, that's kind of what makes the racing so cool, is you have to adjust and adapt to the different conditions. And, you know, this is just one of those conditions.
Even though qualifying wasn't the disaster it was the previous year, Ty still struggled with the surface.
Kind of every race we've been to here is just training as a warm-up, just trying to figure stuff out. Figure out the surface, it's been a little different every time, so.
Regardless, he was very confident that he would have his program figured out in time for the Worlds.
I think we're set pretty good, depending on the track conditions are. But it looks like it's going to be fairly high bite and smooth, so our car is really good on that. I think we'll be set pretty good for the Worlds, I think.
He wouldn't be the only one that would struggle. The entire Kyosho team would be kept off the podium.
There's rumors that they're going to keep it like this, or they're not going to keep it like this, because apparently they're not allowed to keep to water the track during the World, so he needs to try and keep it an even surface. But personally for me, it doesn't feel quite right, this surface to race on. It's not going to be a very good race because it's one line. When it's high grip, like, it's like temp scale. Once you qualify, it's pretty much done.
The Vegas clay was proving to be a challenge for the drivers to figure out. Fortunately, everyone would have more than enough time. Daniel Adams was only on trip 3, a total of 15 trips to Las Vegas this year. The buggy A-Main rolls out and is led off by TQ Spencer Rivkin. Spencer, who is not known for his prowess in the 8-scale class, has put in an amazing run here at Silver State. But would youthful energy be enough to hold off the years of veteran experience behind him? Incumbent champion Jared Tebow would battle hard, but he would not at any point in the race contest for the win.
The last time I was here, the track was completely polar opposite. It was like the loosest track ever, and now it's, you know, the most hooked up track ever. So, you know, I just gotta get the confidence back. Had some good runs here. I think my speed's good. Just seems like every run I'm like right there, you know, somewhere between first and fifth. And then it just ended up making a silly driver error, which, you know, is just on me. So I need to drive a little bit better.
Ty, with the help of lightning fast pit stops, would work his way as high as second place, well within striking distance of the leader. A late race tumble would drop him to his finishing spot of third place. In a sport of confidence, losing a race at the World's venue is always hard to take.
I mean, the World's is here, so it's cool to win, you know,
win at the track, but, you know, that's 6 months away. You know, we have no idea what's coming, what the track's going to be, what the temperature's going to be. I mean, hell, it could be raining by the time we're running the mains of the World, so we just don't know. But I'm not a big fan of the surface, but I understand why they're doing it. IFMAR's not going to allow them to water, and the temperature is not going to allow for water to stay on the track. It's going to be super inconsistent. So this is the most consistent track he can build to sustain for 10 days. Maybe IFMAR needs to look at their rules a little bit and allow tracks to do what they need to do to continue to be the track that they chose in the first place.
While IFMAR is not an organization that is really known for its flexibility,
take it away.
They would in fact allow the Vegas track to be watered for the Worlds. Next up was yet another installment of the Neo race. This race is often referred to as the Indoor Worlds, and it would once again bring five-time champ Tebow to the UK over the Easter weekend.
I'm ready to just win. I haven't won for a while. Haven't won the last two times I've been at Neo, so I'm here to win.
With a dominant run in the main final, Jared would earn his sixth Neo title. Elliot, finishing third, was clearly disappointed. Did nerves get the better of him?
I think it's good to be a bit nervous. Shows that it means something. I think everyone gets nervous in their own ways. I get a bit nervous, but you have to control it and perhaps transform that into performance on the track, make yourself better on the track.
With the surprising decision by IFMAR that the Worlds would be run on a more traditional off-road track, Boots would again head stateside for two more events. The first event he would attend would be the Gas Champs at the Pro Line Test Track.
The track is at the Worlds is going to be loose and loamy and rough, like what this is here. So it's not exactly like what the Vegas track is going to be, but I would say that we can get a good reading at least for our cars.
Gas Champs was good.
Everybody had fun, and it was cool to have international guys at our track because we really don't get that very often. We had Ronnefalk there and Elliot Boots, and that was cool to watch those guys race on our track. So.
The A-Main here would see Ryan Lutz take the win with David Ronnefalk and Joe Bornhorst rounding out the podium. Would this race be a good test for the Worlds?
Anytime you're used to dealing with a bumpy track and in a low grip situation, the two different setups are going to play a part in some way, shape, or form. So, yeah, I definitely think it helps a little bit,
Back in Vegas, the official IFMAR Worlds Warmup race. Elliot Boots and David Ronnefalk, who just finished competing at the Gas Champs, headed to Vegas to compete in the warmup.
Real decent.
Either by the hand of the track crew or by Mother Nature, the track would be run wet this weekend.
I think it's interesting. It's back to the roots of off-road. Drivers seem to be enjoying it quite a lot. It's a little bit bumpy, but I think it's good. I think it would be good for the world if it's run like this.
A-scale racing, this is where it came from real dirt and water, and and that's what we need to get back to instead of this kind of man-made surface. So I think it's good.
While Ryan Mayfield, winner of the Silver State race held here only a couple months ago, was a fan of the surface, he might not be a fan of his results so far. He was struggling to keep pace with the likes of Cavallari, McBride, and Tessman. His buggy looked very unsettled and hard to drive on the bumpy warm-up track. David Ronnefalk and Ty Tessman would be the drivers to beat on this weekend. Ty would be the top qualifier heading into the semifinals. But does this warm-up race really mean anything, or is it nothing more than practice?
I think it would mean something. It just, kind of give whoever wins it, just going to give them confidence going into Worlds. But it's definitely not super important.
No, it means something. So everyone, no matter who says that they don't care about winning, they care about winning it. So it's another race. It counts towards the top 25. So everyone's trying to win, and so am I.
Win or lose, I want to drive an hour main and a 30-minute semi without crashing very much. So that's my goal.
With threatening clouds beginning to surround Las Vegas, the 30-minute semifinal is set to begin, with Ty on point. Qualifying third overall, Ryan Mayfield would start right behind him in the odd grouping.
26 minutes of racing to go, Tessman and Mayfield.
Corner by corner, bump by bump, Ty would inch away from Ryan. The rough track conditions definitely showed that Mayfield's buggy's handling left a lot to be desired. Even though Ryan would soon fall off Ty's pace, he would fend off Dakota and McBride and hold on to third overall. The semifinals concluded just as the rain came in. The main final would not be run. Team HB would dominate the event, with Ronnefalk in second and Ty, who earned the pole position coming out of the semis, would take the win.
I don't know if it's a win. It's just based on qualifying, but yeah, it is what it is. It's rain, and nothing you can do about it, really. We could have ran in the rain, but we'd had no marshals, and cars would have been wrecked, so I think it was a good decision.
The way I look at it is if we raced here now, it wouldn't be a true test of learning anything. It's about 4 hours car cleanup, and I'd rather be testing for 4 hours tomorrow and learning something for the Worlds rather than cleaning a car.
We can test tomorrow, and I think get some more learning done than we could have running the main.
The season was winding down, and it was again time for the Roar Nationals. Usually this is one of the races that the top drivers want to win, but this year, a win here at the Roar National is not as coveted as it usually is. Nevertheless, the competition was fierce. Ryan Mayfield would match Ty's feet from the Chico Nats last year by TQing 5 of the 6 rounds. The mains, however, were a completely different story. Ryan would make more errors in this final than he did the entire race weekend. As a result, it was Spencer Rivkin who would take the win and earn his first major 8-scale Nitro victory. Ty's struggles at the Roar Nats would be wiped out with dominance at the Southern Nationals. With just over 2 weeks to go, this would be the last race before the Worlds. The Southern Nats track, with its big air and equally big bumps, would be yet another great test for the Worlds track, which would feature some of the same conditions.
Yeah, this was a really good test for it because the track blew out really bad. It was a little more high speed than I think that track is or has been in the past. So our car worked really, really well. It handled the bumps, handled the jumps, and Ty drove around everything, which is what it's going to take to win the Worlds. It's someone that's smart. I don't think necessarily the fastest car on the track is going to win the world. It's going to be the guy who drives smart.
The wait is finally over. Drivers from around the world converge on Las Vegas, Nevada for the 16th running of the 8-scale Off-Road World Championships. The auspicious day is finally here. The 2016 IFMAR Worlds are about to kick off. With more than 320 competitors from 43 different countries, The Vegas Worlds are the largest 8-scale worlds ever held.
USA! USA!
Each and every racer here would love nothing more than to walk away with this trophy. In 2014, if you were to ask any RC enthusiast who was going to win the title, you would have been hard-pressed to find someone that would not have said Tessman. The same cannot be said for these worlds. While this could very well be anyone's race to win, the odds-on favorite was Ryan Mayfield. Over the past season and a half, simply put, he's been on a tear. He's had wins at DNC, Silver State, Psycho Nitro Blast, and more. Time and time again, the driver that was expected to win has walked away from the Worlds empty-handed. No one would have guessed that Hara would win in 2008, or King in 2010, or Battier in 2012. There are just so many factors that go into winning this standalone event.
You know, to determine a world champion is only one event. It'd be nice if we could kind of spread it out over a couple different tracks and time frames and see who really could stand out through a whole year of racing.
Another one of these factors is watering. For the first time, in longer than anyone we talked to could remember, the track at the IFMAR Worlds will be watered. This decision, coupled with the fact that the track would be loose, has most of the drivers cautiously optimistic.
Yeah, they're kind of worried about the water whenever they water all the time. If they keep it even, the track's kind of different in the beginning of the runs. But it won't matter in the mains because it's going to be dry the whole time, so it's going to be good.
Sadly, this wouldn't be a story about an IFMAR event without just a little bit of controversy.
I don't even want to get started on it.
One of the controversies this year would be affectionately referred to as Wingate.
No, it's just a big pain. I don't understand. I was in the Worlds in Argentina. I think they had the same problem with wings. So, I don't know.
The issue was surrounding the height of the side dams of the wings.
They have a rule that they started to enforce this race, that we just kind of had to make our wing work. I think they said because one manufacturer had the wing now, they have one actually for this race, so they enforced it, whereas they didn't in the past. But I think we're over that now, kind of. We got it figured out and just move forward from now on.
As it turns out, only the Kyosho wings were in compliance with the rules. Ultimately, Wingate was little more than an annoyance and was overshadowed by the positive vibe the track surface has caused.
Oh, I think it's one of the best for sure. The track is like really normal dirt, slippy, dusty, bumpy. I think it's, for my opinion, I think it is a little off-road, so I really enjoy with this.
It's really getting back to kind of the roots of this. There's nothing wrong with high traction tracks or sugar tracks, but it's changing so much that this is really kind of back to what we saw in off-road 5 or 10 years ago, and it adds character to the track and really makes it a lot more unpredictable.
It's real surface now. It's going to break up a bit, I think, but at the moment it's nice to drive. Fast, smooth track. I like it.
The track's evolving and getting some character to it. I think it's going to make for some good racing, and whoever's the more consistent person, I think that's who's going to win.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's not too bad. It's getting, I think it's getting to the point now where it's starting to blow out now. There's bumps appearing and lap times have just gone. So it's evolving or devolving.
Maximum 100%.
Would the track blow out to the levels we saw at the 2015 Silver State race? Jared Tebow, winner at that race, certainly hopes it does.
First or second lap went way back, and yeah, put a good charge in, and that was a lot of fun. It ended good for me, so we'll see. Hopefully the track's similar to that.
I don't think it'll get that bad. I mean, I don't know. I think it'll get character. I don't think it's going to blow out. So, at least that's what I hope.
Yesterday, when we drove around the track, and I mean, you couldn't really feel the bumps. There was like one or two spots out there that where you can feel like the bump catch your car. But now it was like almost every corner out there.
You know, everyone's saying that the track's holding up really good, which I agree it is, but we're still just getting started. I mean, we're not even finished with practice yet, so I think it's going to get pretty rough.
With one round of practice still remaining, It's clear that this track will indeed deteriorate to levels we've not seen at this facility.
You know, a lot of people kind of don't remember that. That Silver City was smooth all of qualifying. It didn't blow out until the very, very end. And it's already getting a lot of bumps. So yeah, I think it's going to be really rough, which I enjoy. Yeah, should suit me good.
In fact, Kyosho buggies like Yuji Kanai's from 2000 would have been used the last time we saw track conditions somewhat close to these, 16 years ago.
By a lot.
Yeah.
The final heats hit the track in the final round of practice. Four total rounds of practice were run, and this one, from a setup perspective, could very well be the only meaningful round.
It's pretty fun. It's starting to get a little bit of rust developing, but I think it's just going to get better and better as it gets bumpier. So it started out smooth, and it's been smoother than I thought it would be for this, how far we are in right now.
While his 10-minute time was fast, Tessman's run had an unusually wet track, and his best three laps weren't all that great. A somewhat unexpected driver did throw down an amazing seeding practice run. Italian star driver Davide Ongaro would emerge from the final practice with the second fastest seeding time. But just as it was at the Messina Worlds 2 years ago, David Ronnefalk emerged from practice with the three fastest consecutive laps.
The track has been good. I think now it's turning out to be a little bit more blown out than before. The layout is cool. I like it a lot. And so far everything has been working good. Car, engine, tires seem to be working at the right moment. So we have a base for now, and just working on a small few tweaks here and there, and just to find the consistency of the car, basically. And yeah, I feel really good, as I said. So I can't wait for the qualifying and main to start.
Lower practice heats raced well into the evening, but no one could touch David's time. Not even Jared Tebow, who struggled putting together three fast consecutive laps.
My three-lap pace, it seems like every time I'm not really taking my best lap. So it's really hard to read off that. I think my 10-minute pace is going to be awesome. So, and I'm excited for tomorrow. I can't wait.
While practice was days shorter than the last Worlds, with the track conditions just now being near to what they will be in qualifying, it does beg the question, is practice at the Worlds still too long?
The track it's still developing. So we keep practicing and practicing and practicing and kind of beating up the track, and I'm ready to go racing.
Well, I'm not a crook. I've earned everything I've got.
Day one of qualifying starts with the track crew soaking the track for the first heat, twice. At most events, all the top-seeded drivers end up in the same qualifying heat. To keep things dramatic, IFMAR does things just a bit differently. The top 30 drivers will be spread out through the first three heats. This means that the fastest drivers from seeding practice were not in the same heat race. They would not race head-to-head until the semifinals, 4 days from now. The day one schedule has the top drivers running first thing, on a soaking wet track.
You know, when you set the car up for fairly dry conditions and they ground the track, not real good.
No one in the first two heats has a chance at TQing the first round. The drivers were frustrated, to say the very least.
I don't think it's fair at all. I mean, I guess we're all getting water, so it's as fair as it can be when you're watering a track every run. But the track is ever changing. I mean, even from what the guys in race one had versus what I had, their track dried out quicker than my track. And then same with the race three and same with race four. So, and now it's going the opposite. Now the track's drying out even faster. So it's just like an up and down. You're battling the sun, you're battling the wind, you're battling the weather, the changing weather, and now you're battling the water. So, I mean, I think with watering in general, it's as fair as it can be, but from when you start your practice to when the race ends, the track is completely different.
I think it was definitely wetter, so it was a little bit slower, but the second round should be okay because it's more in the daytime, it should dry out
faster. And I think this is the only time we're going to have to run early, so I think we'll be okay from here on out.
While the drivers were optimistic that round two would bring more consistent watering, they were in for more of the same. Heat one would see puddles on the track, which all but took this heat out of TQ contention for yet another round.
It's hard because the times just dropped right off. But if you look at the track, you can't really see why everybody's going that much slower. You know, all the top guys have gone a lot slower.
You just had no grip. Just the track, I think it was just too wet. Just no grip. Basically, I think they had to break in the track again because they put so much water in it.
Ty would do his absolute best, and he would be the highest qualifying driver from the first heat. But it would only be good enough for fifth place.
I think it's definitely a disadvantage for the first heat because they water a lot more and then they start to fade off and then the track gets faster. So that hopefully will happen tomorrow with being us being on the first race. I think the tires that we are planning to run should work better.
TQ of practice. David Ronnefalk was also in the first heat and would struggle even more than his teammate.
Yeah, I mean, you can see, I mean, everybody in my heat is lower basically than the other two. I think heat number three is the one you want to be in today. Obviously, we were in the first heat, so I think we got the worst track out there. With them, they flooded the track twice before our heat, so that kind of sucks. But that's how it is, and it won't be the same for tomorrow. I think it'll be more fair tomorrow, and I'm looking forward to go out there tomorrow again.
Day one did not go the way the testmans had hoped for, but is the worst of it behind them?
We're going to throw those two rounds out and start tomorrow again. They can't do it to us anymore because we're not running first, so the rest of the week should be good.
The conditions are throwing even the most veteran of drivers for a loop.
Normal tracks do, I guess. You know, all your notes from every other race you've been to kind of don't necessarily seem to be true here with this dirt. And, you know, it is what it is. It's what the cards were dealt. And we're going to figure out what teams come to the top and who comes together and figure stuff out.
Not expecting track conditions to go the way they have, Proline, who initially didn't bring enough tires in the M4 compound, had their night shift run an emergency batch. The new batch was packed and sent to the track with Tim Clark. Elliot Boots, one of the lucky 10 drivers in Heat 3, grabs a set in hopes of taking TQ, which is still up for grabs.
But I didn't cut them like the tire was cutting them.
I'm gonna try that for next one.
Uh-huh.
So for me, the hole shots fell off too, but it could have been the track.
Yeah, they do fall off, but not as much.
Yeah.
On my car.
Right.
Day one has resulted in Heat 1 and 2 riding off their runs as drops.
I think they're doing a really good job watering, and it's been as consistent as it possibly can. It's just the weather each day has been totally different.
Heat 3, with a visibly drier track, rolls out and dominates.
Oh man, super happy with that run. Perfect start for me, you know. Car felt good, drove really well. Didn't have, you know, any mistakes at all the whole run. And I think I just lost some time, like the first couple laps. My car felt pretty loose in the wet. Me and Elliot were on different tire setup. I think he kind of got that 3-second gap, you know, really early.
Elliot Boots, who struggled to put three fast consecutive laps together yesterday, decided to string 17 consecutive fast laps together today instead. He was driving absolutely full punch. Surprisingly, his aggressive driving style appears to suit the bumpy track. For now.
I was working it all day yesterday, really, because everyone was looking for the three laps. But, yesterday I was trying to go for the full run and it worked out well. Bit of traffic, but today now we're in better heat, so it was a lot better. I'm going to have to race to get past people. Track's cutting up a bit, but you know, the car's working really, really well. Tires are hooked up in that one, in the M4 hole shots. All in all, engine was perfect, all worked together, and
came good at the end.
He maintained a 3-second gap over Tebow and held it all the way to the end of the 10-minute qualifier. He would be round one TQ.
Tried a different set of tires in the second run. Kind of happy I tried them just because I got it out of my mind, but kind of bummed to throw a runaway. You know, some other guys kind of crashed and had some mistakes, and I think I really could have battled for the TQ if I had the same set of tires I ran in the first run. So got a 7 in the second run, which, you know, for how much I didn't like the feeling of the car, I feel like I drove really, really good. So, you know, that was positive, but, you know, don't want to take a 7. So we'll see. Got 4 more runs. I'm excited for tomorrow.
With one good run in the books for round two, Jared would experiment slightly in the last run of the day. With Elliott again being faster than his teammate, would they share any setup data? Or are their driving styles just too different?
But me and him don't like anything the same. Our cars are very different. Driving styles are very different.
Elliott, running essentially the same setup as the first round, struggled a bit on the track that is now deteriorating. He was forced to change up his lines significantly, and this resulted in a much slower run than this morning. While his time was 11 seconds off the pace of his first round time, he would finish 4 seconds ahead of Ryan Cavallari and would once again TQ.
Figueredo will finish 5th, Taylor Peterson 6th, Alex
So far, it has been a dominating performance by Elliott Boots, but he's been here before, at the Argentina World in 2012. Boots walked away with TQ that year only to break a plastic servo arm in the semifinal. Would history repeat itself?
Well, I don't want to think about what happened in Argentina, but it'd be nice to get the TQ, but I don't want the rest of it. So hopefully, yeah, I mean, we'll see.
Yeah, today was good. You know, I had a lot of solid runs out of, you know, Elliott and Jared and you know, Ty and Yorn and, you know, a bunch of the other gang. And, yeah, it was good. We kind of migrated to a softer compound, the M4 stuff, and it seems to be working well. And everybody seems to be getting their, you know, their cars dialed in, and yeah, it was awesome. It was a good day of racing. You know, we're kind of winding it down. There's still quite a few races left to go for the night, but overall, I think it was good, and I think our guys got a lot of confidence going in tomorrow.
To win this race, everything has to click. You know, everything has to come together. It can't just, not always the fastest guy wins the race.
Day two of the Vegas Worlds begins. Would we see more dominance from Kyosho's Elliott Boots, or would these worlds start to take some unexpected turns, as they almost always do?
Speechless right now. An unbelievable feat for an almost unknown driver. What an amazing, amazing...
Could we see yet another relatively unknown driver win this year?
You know, if I'm happy with how I drove and I finished 20th, then so be it, but... You know, I know I can do better than that as long as I don't crash.
Dylan Rodriguez, a local to this track who earned his spot for this race last year in Chico, is set to hit the world track on this second day of qualifying. His first day of qualifying didn't go all that well. When day one ends, he would be 66th overall. This is an underwhelming start for Dylan, who is capable of so much better. Dylan would finish qualifying in the 8th finals. He has been known to quite successfully play the bump game in the past. He would be doing so again.
Oh yeah, that's all right, that's where I shine, so. Pole Nitro Challenge 2014 all over again.
But would he be there at the end? And what of Cody King? The unexpected 2010 world champion hasn't been making a lot of headlines at these worlds. He was, however, quietly working his way well into a semi-final position.
It's just the way I am. Sometimes I'm really good at qualifying and sometimes I'm not that good at it. So I'm normally pretty decent in the mains and the semis. So yeah, I kind of just don't put pressure on myself.
The pressure of being a world champion has followed Cody since 2010. At each event, fans, media, and spectators expect a follow-up performance.
does this pressure weigh him down?
After that, and I think you know that, and it's difficult just to get your mindset back into not thinking about that, but that's probably one of the hardest things that there's to do. Once I get in the mains, I'm really good at pacing people and how fast they're going in sections. But it's all about, it's a long week of racing, so it's all about just staying fresh and getting a lot of sleep and, you know, just making sure that you're fresh every day that you get to the track and really watching what's going on because the track's changing so much. And
his march towards the top of the leaderboard wasn't exactly halted, but he hits a significant snag in the last round of day two.
I guess kind of operator error, honestly. We did our pit and the gas tank lid got stuck on the body. So, yeah. I've never had that happen before, that's crazy. And we've cut our bodies the same.
It would only happen on those.
Of course. But good thing it happened now, I guess. So we're done for the day.
Cody wasn't alone in his struggles. Adam seems to be having problems with his buggy.
I wouldn't really say I've been having a problem with the buggy. I just overall have kind of felt disconnected and feel like the car's kind of been on top of the track. I switched radios, radio trays, pretty much everything. And then for the last run, I actually just completely switched cars. So I went to just my normal kind of practice car, JBRL car that I run at smaller races, and was considerably better. Like I said, still not perfect, but a lot to build on.
These drivers put so much pressure on themselves, but in all reality, at this stage of the event, all the competitors really need to do is to be inside the top 20 to earn a spot in the semifinals. Adam has done exactly that. Mike Truey, TQ of the 2008 Worlds, would join him there.
All right, let's say
solid day. Had a couple, little oopsies on the tracks that cost, you know, one little wreck here will cost you 10 spots. Two top 20 runs, or I think one was 21st and one was like 12th, so not a bad start.
Well, those pit stops really.
I mean, ultimately, matter getting in the semis. I mean, the difference between TQ and 19 spots only 30 feet. So, you know, you got to get it. You know, you want to start higher up in the semis, get a good start. But TQ is good for it's good for confidence going to the, you know, going to the semis knowing that you've been consistently fast here. But for the outcome, you know, that doesn't necessarily mean anything.
Even struggling Mayfield seems totally content to simply make it into the semifinals, where absolutely anything can happen.
It's getting worse and worse and worse. And I mean, I think I'm running up in the top, you know, six or seven or whatever. So I got some decent runs. Like, nothing really matters till Saturday. So we're having a good time. The weather's been nice. Just chilling, man, having a good time.
Elliot Boots, being atop the leaderboard, is in a different state of mind to Adam, Mike, and Ryan. He was looking to make a statement. He would fall short of his own expectations in round five.
Elliot, as most of us know, is on the gas pretty hard usually, so it doesn't help when he's heating him up like that.
It's blowing out quite badly now, a lot of places, so you just got to take it quite easy out there now, which I learned the hard way.
Frustrated with the track, more than just a few drivers resorted to the most unconventional of tread patterns.
1993 called, they want their tires back.
Should I grab the crime fighters while I'm at it, too?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, some of the guys, especially European guys, they like a big pin tire, so I know Dylan likes to drive a little punch and he likes to catch some holes, so a bow tie, I think, kind of suit him in that round. He was actually up there doing really well with him, so we'll see.
It's worrying that you get drug off your program because somebody goes fast on something.
That's how it, that's,
I mean,
it can either get you or make you bet faster. Yeah. That's why I think you got to look at each individual's driving style.
I mean,
some
Elliot
guys can
was,
drive it
he
like
was
that.
Driving hard. You yeah. know, it wasn't.
Would Ty get drug off his tire program? Would Elliot?
The car was quite loose then. The Jared ran the M3, so maybe I'll try them in the next one. One run to throw out. We've got two first, so just back them up now. It's on the verge of being a bit, I'm fun to drive, but it's just okay.
Jared, showcasing his rough track driving skills, would handily TQ the third round.
You know, me and Elliot have a lot different driving style. But for me, picking the lines is something that I really enjoy. When the track is, you know, really smooth, there's only one line, the fast line. So this, you know, I feel like is really enjoyable for me. Yeah, that was a good run, man. That was a lot of fun out there. The track was a blast. It was getting super rough and, you know, had to be creative on some lines and felt comfortable out there.
Does Jared's motocross background help him in the rough, or is it simply a matter of Elliot's full punch driving style finally catching up to him?
To go and walk around the track and really like think about it all day and watch even the slower guys, and you know, they might accidentally go in a really weird line and I might see it and like, oh, you know, that looked pretty good. So, you know, I can be really creative and it just adds a whole nother aspect to it that I enjoy.
Ty has an impressive run in the third round, finishing a mere 3 seconds behind Jared. This run all but wipes out his struggles from day one. It does get a bit chippy for him on his last run of the day, though. Ty still finishes fourth, but more importantly, has built up some confidence in his program.
We're pretty confident in our tire selection now, I think. Just kind of have to drive around the bumps and make the best of the track, really. And I think you're going to need to conserve your car, especially for the semi and the main. Can't go out there full punch, so I think it kind of suits more of my driving style, so I think we're going to be set for the mains, even if qualifying doesn't quite go my way.
Boots got tangled in, put some traffic. Chris Boots watches his son once again struggle on the track.
The guys are coming in between 2 and 8 minutes.
This second run on the day would probably be the most important round of qualifying at these Worlds. It would be the only round run under the lights. With IFMAR breaking tradition and running the main final at night, the importance of this run cannot be emphasized enough. It would be David Ronnefalk, with a flawless run, taking top qualifying honors for the round.
Yesterday was kind of a waiting game for today, this day to come, and today the track crew made a great job keeping the track consistent, and they really improved since yesterday. It also helped with our, like, the top heat being run in the middle of the round. So yeah, now you can see in the rest, it's like the more guys from the heat one are up there. So today was a great day for us. We improved the car a lot, and also my driving was really good in the last one. So yeah, it feels really good with the TQ now before sleeping, and then another qualifying day tomorrow.
With a second place finish, Jared would assume the overall TQ spot heading into the final day of qualifying.
Yeah, really happy. It's going really good. You know, if I end up second, I have 2 seconds and a TQ going into the last day, and yeah, that's really good. I'm happy with everything so far. So just trying to sort some feeling stuff out with the engine and kind of just fuel strategy, you know, trying to decide what to do. And yeah, we'll see how tomorrow goes.
Yeah, it's a tough one, really, from going from what we did yesterday. But, you know, we've got to stay focused because there's two more rounds tomorrow. And we can, we've got to keep fighting and see if we can get a TQ. We know we're in the semis now, which is good. So that's a bit of pressure off there. But yeah, no, it's just watching the track's developing.
crazy. I mean, the bumps are just growing.
You gonna go for tens in the semis?
Not sure. I'm not sure yet. So that's what we're trying to figure out.
The final day of qualifying is upon us. When practice concluded, everyone was surprised how well the track was holding up. This was no longer the case. The racing line no longer exists. Landing zones have been carved out to the point where simple double is now a rhythm section.
Yeah, it's, I mean, with the old boulder track, it got really bumpy too, but this has got a, I think the other day when I checked, it already had like 49,000 laps on it, so it's doing pretty good. I mean, that's just, you know, cars straight up landing in it and kind of digging a hole, but it's going to make for some good racing. I think we needed a rough track, so it'll be fun. Nobody can say that, you know, it wasn't a true off-road track for this world, for sure. So there's no concrete section, there's just a paver section, there's nothing, no carpet, like it's true off-road. So it's definitely going to come down to the guy that doesn't make any mistakes and can get the car around the bumps.
Staying on top of setup will absolutely be key on this final day of qualifying. For the past 2 days of qualifying, the testmans have been struggling a bit in trying to find the right shock package. He and Dakota are virtually tied for the fifth overall qualifying spot. Both have, at times, struggled and have also found success. Would one of them have a breakout run on this final day of qualifying? Or are they, like many of the other top drivers, content to simply make it into the semifinals?
Ty's never been known for a qualifier. He's more of a racer, and we'll be there, barring a catastrophe. We'll be there.
While Ty did struggle at times at the Messina Worlds, his struggles there pale in comparison to what he is going through at these Worlds.
The 130 down, 8:30 left to go. Joe Bornhorst, your leader. Ty Tessman second. David Ronnefalk in third.
AC Race and Buggy.
So far, he also has 3 TDs, and AC Racing has.
So the track has slowed down about 2 seconds over the last set.
Tessman has a slow start, but he slowly makes his way towards the front. His lap times only mirror those of Ronnefalk. Ty would not catch him. He would finish 2 seconds behind David, and after the first two heats, the HB Racing teammates are 1 and 2. Would David's TQ run hold up to Boots or Tebow's? Jared starts out by besting David's hot lap by nearly a half a second, and he has another trick up his sleeve.
Yeah, I mean, we calculated it. We knew it was going to be really close.
I was nervous for sure that last lap. I definitely took it easy.
Jared would be the first driver to do the entire qualifier without stopping for fuel.
Right there, over the Kyosho. First brave soul to try it, and a new TQ.
A last lap crash makes the time closer than it should have been, but he is TQ for the second time.
He finished up, and when he stopped at the end of the straight, he still had some fuel left in it, so he could have probably came in that next lap, but yeah, it was close.
You know, I wanted to have a little bit more gap than that, but shoot, you know, that's a TQ. A TQ is a TQ no matter how close it is. So happy I made it. You know, not sure if I'll do it in the last one. We'll see. I wasn't able to see how much fuel I had afterwards.
Jared did the risk it or biscuit technique and went for the full 10 and was able to take the TQ from David. So yeah, it was good. And then he had Ty in third and then a slew of others right behind him. So yeah, it's pretty awesome.
The testmans have been known for good fuel economy, so it does come as a bit of a surprise that Jared was the first competitor to try this strategy.
I'm just a big chicken, that's all. So we got
We got four good ones now, so we're going to do it on the last one. Which hopefully we should be able to get TQ, because our pace is good. We're right there. Should be good.
While this final day of qualifying started out well for Ty, who was third overall, Dakota had a disastrous run. He wasn't even inside the top 20 in round five.
The last run was kind of rough. I made some changes just trying to see if we could get the car a little bit better, and it did not work out. So now we know not to go in that direction. So going back to what we did before and made another change, it'll make it a little bit better through the bumps and should be good to go.
Round six would be even worse for him. The track conditions are continuing to worsen. At this point, Ty has guaranteed a spot in the semifinals. For this final qualifying run, the Tessman camp is only trying to improve their starting position for the semis. As in the previous round, David is leading the heat. Ty, only 2 seconds behind him, has absolutely no intentions of pitting. Even though David is slightly quicker than Ty at this point, the 5 second save by skipping the pit stop could propel Tessman past him.
I was on a good run. I didn't feel really fast, but I didn't make any mistakes. I didn't pit, so I was on a good time. I was coming up on a lapper, and on the option section, they went wide and went around, and then I was jumping the jump, and he came in right in the line, and I landed right on top of him, and his shock tower must have hit my flywheel and just stopped it dead right there. Pretty disappointing, but it's better it happens today than just kind of get the bad luck out of the way rather than Saturday, so.
Well, Mickey managed to get me out in a better track position this time. I had a better, clear track I had out there, which helps because then you can drive your own lines. I walked the track in the lunch break, and I managed to just drive around all the bumps and keep on the clean line. If I did hit a bump, take it steady, just try not to make any mistakes. I had a few little bubbles, but nothing major, no marshals, so that helped a lot. I mean, that's what it takes when everyone's crashing out there, and if you can keep a clean run, you know, you can get a good run. So, all in all, we got the car set up now for the finals, and we're ready to go for the finals and have a pace, which is always good.
Even though Elliot TQ'd the final round with a blistering hot lap and pace, Jared edged him out in the points and would secure the overall TQ for the 2016 IFMAR Worlds.
So I think he beat me by 1 point. But, yeah. I've TQ'd before and not made the final, so anything can happen.
Elliot knows all too well from experience that absolutely anything can happen at the Worlds.
Yeah, I mean, he took the option line. He took the option line.
Yeah.
Ty jumped on top of him.
Yeah.
I mean, I've done it. He just caught the shock tower and cut the engine, I guess.
I guess he said it looked like metal-to-metal contact, so it's probably just a shock tower.
I mean, those shock towers in technos are like
3 feet
high.
Right.
Yeah, it was really good. We ended up with 5 out of the 6 rounds, and Jared got the overall. There's a lot of great racing, a lot of great battles going on, and really excited to see what happens, going through the semis and into the finals on Saturday.
Qualifying at the 2016 IFMAR Worlds was in the books, as they say. Jared was the top qualifier, and at this point looks poised to be the man to beat this year. Like Elliot, Jared has also been here before and lost. The finals will be run over the next 2 days. The majority of the participants that attend a Worlds event are here only to experience the atmosphere. They are hobbyists and realize that winning this race is completely out of the realm of possibilities. But that doesn't mean they can't have a party.
Being a hobbyist doesn't mean that there is no intensity, however.
Come on! Get off!
This is the 1/2048th main, and Warren Fundamarva is closing in on his second consecutive bump. His pit crew, consisting of his wife and brother, are as invested in this run as Warren himself is. While the Fundamarva team was busy pulling off a triple bump, back in the pits, the semi-finalists are busy prepping their buggies.
He did good. Made the bump. And the long haul driver. Not a sprint guy, but I feel like if I was here a whole week, maybe we would have done a little bit better. But unfortunately, duty calls. So. But it's all right. We're there. We just got a little more track time in the meantime. So. We're rebuilding the whole thing. The car's already had an hour's with the runtime on it. And it's about to have another hour on it. So we want to make sure that everything is done 100%. When he bumps to the final, I will be probably doing this all over again. But I'm gonna give him the best shot he can get. So I'm gonna do my part and give him the best car he can have.
Getting smoother. Can't believe it.
Both the odd and even groups have just finished their warm-up sessions, and it has been an entire day since the top drivers have hit the track. And they are surprised at the changes the track has undergone.
You want to avoid that.
The track's pretty bad. It's pretty loose out there. So just discussing about what to do with tires and what we need to do.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's like you just don't know. Nobody really stands out as a clear favorite. Obviously, Jared and Elliott were both fast in qualifying, but there's also people, Ty and David, who were also very quick as well. And then, I mean, I always consider Cavalier and Mayfield, they're always a threat no matter what main they're in. So, yeah, step one is getting into the semi, and or getting out of the semi and getting a good starting spot for the main.
I felt a little nervous out there. I feel like I got in my groove about halfway through. So, that was just practice. Normally, if I have a bad practice, I have a good race. So.
It was good. I had tried two different tires and found what tire I want now. So my car was good and found the lines around the track, so hopefully it's semi-goal.
Drivers and mechanics thrash on their buggies, preparing for the semifinals. In the next 60 minutes, eight dreams of IFMAR fame will come to an unceremonious end. The semifinal. This is, bar none, the most stressful part of an international RC competition. For the fans of this sport, the semifinals are pure, unadulterated excitement. For the drivers and pit crews, they are sure to take years off their lives. Top qualifier Jared Tebow will lead the field off in the odd final. The start is clean for the front runners, but not everyone got a good start.
Semifinal was brutal. Crashed right out of the gate, was last. But actually it was super calm. Just I knew I had one less stop than everyone. Just wanted to kind of stay with the pack. Was able to for a little bit. Got together with someone on the straightaway, crashed in the middle of the straightaway. It was just kind of no man's land. Then tried to push a little bit and just made some costly mistakes and came up short. So, see you in Australia in 2 years.
Adam Drake's worlds are over. Given how hard he has worked, it has to be a huge disappointment for him. Jared, starting from pole, loses the lead on the very first lap. He is in the fourth position as he is about to go a lap down to the leader in a very young semifinal race.
All right, 24 down, 6 to go.
He would manage to hold on to a bump position, but the confidence that Jared had coming in from qualifying is now totally gone.
To 2 minutes, we'll see who opts for the two pit stop strategy versus the three.
Dakota Fend, who has had a very quiet Worlds thus far, is on point and looks to be poised to dominate this semifinal.
This kid is second, only 15 years old, relatively unknown here in the United States. Super fast.
But what kind of IFMAR story would this be without a bit of drama?
Here's Dakota Fend over with the plane out. So that's a tough break for Dakota Fend in the TLR with the flame out.
I think it's in the pit lane. I think it didn't get full all the way. So it just kind of ran out a little bit early. We got started like 3 seconds to spare before I lost fifth place. So just in the nick of time.
Nick of time, so everything going to change. Here's Ronnefalk down the straightaway. Here's Ongaro down the straightaway.
Even with the flame out, he would earn a spot in the final. Hometown favorite Dylan Rodriguez would not be quite so fortunate. While Dylan briefly held down sixth place, he finishes ninth in the odd group. This isn't good enough to make the cut for the final.
I don't know. I hate losing. I always want to do better. So I know I could do better than that, so that's the disappointing part.
So what does the future hold for Dylan?
Unknown right now.
Caution on the straight. Caution on the straight.
This is how the sport of RC can go sometimes. One of the most naturally talented drivers could very well walk away from the sport forever.
In next, Renault Savoia in sixth and Ogden in seventh. They're racing for laps and times, and they got.
Meanwhile, David Ronnefalk has held onto the lead uncontested after Dakota's flame out. And he is driving full punch. 30 minutes and 34 seconds later, David would end the semi with a 49-lap run and the win. But the big surprise coming out of the semis would be the young Italian, Davide Ongaro. Not only did he earn a spot in the final, but he did it by hero lapping David and only finishing 1 second behind him. As Ronnefalk's pace slowed, was he holding back, or has Ongaro made a huge jump forward? If so, this is definitely the perfect time for the young Italian to step up his game. The even semi was on deck, and with drivers like Boots, Tessmann, Cavallari, McBride, Battier, and Mayfield, it was an absolutely stacked heat.
Drivers ready. Three. 2, 1, down and quiet. And they're off 30 minutes of racing.
Unlike the first semi that saw pole setter Tebow lose his lead in the first lap, Elliott, with an amazing Ronnefalkian style line through the bricks, would pull a small gap over second place.
It was okay, we were lacking a bit of rear end grip. It wasn't spot on, but hopefully when it gets cooler, it'll be back to the conditions that we were. He's okay, but I think he was very nervous. He just wanted to get in the final, and that's it then. He can relax a bit now, enjoy himself.
The second place car was none other than incumbent world champ, Tessmann. Boots would short the center double jump, and Ty would capitalize.
3:15 down, 26:45 to go.
Ty wasted little time in pulling a gap on Elliott. Flustered, Boots would lose another spot to Cavallari. The last thing any of the top competitors really wanted in this semi was to let Ty check out. But in the early goings of this semi, that's exactly what it looked like was going to happen.
It started gripping really good in the corners. I got that corner speed that we've been looking for the whole weekend. So, yeah, and I had some really good lines. I was happy with my pace. And just really never really had to push that hard, really. And my car was accepting everything that I was throwing at it.
In the closing minutes of the race, Cavallari would put on an amazingly hard charge and would pass Testman for the lead. It looked like Cav just might have the win in the bag until a slight bobble on the troublesome center double.
So the battle for the lead continues. Testman all over the back of Cavallari. Oh, a nice pass. Cavallari pushes it.
On this final lap duel, the bumps played against both Cavallari and Testman. On the very last corner, Ty bobbled but had the inside line and gave Cav only one option, contact.
Punt it to him!
Punt it! Wait for one more to finish,
the contact was deemed illegal and Cavallari was issued a 1 second penalty. Cavallari was understandably upset, but he was not the only one. Could have ended a lot worse for the Ryans. Cody King would miss his first IFMAR final in his professional career. Surprisingly, some of the other eliminated drivers weren't all that upset.
I'm proud of myself. I came in with the goal of making the semi, and I achieved my goal. So, first Worlds, I can't really complain for that.
Everything was good. You know, after watching the main, you know, the top three were definitely on a good run and good pace, but I felt like, you know, I had a really good long race car, but you never know. We will never know.
But even though these are the best drivers in the world, not a single one of them had a clean run.
Running, I mean, obviously, Ty was going well, Cavallari, Tebow, any of those guys could win it. You know, it's really, the track is so hard, you know, to run on. And, you just got to be so careful. We got to tiptoe around, really, basically. So it's not really, it is racing, but it's not, if you know what I mean. It's more like you've got to be really careful what you're doing.
I don't think anybody went out there and didn't need to be marshaled at least once or, you know, have five or six bobbles even. So the key is just going to be to get in a groove and just keep putting in laps.
Car was awesome. Got a really good car. Excited just to pretty much clean it up, mount some tires, and go back out and battle.
David Ronnefalk would start third, penalized Cavallari would be second, and incumbent champion Ty Testman would start from pole, a position that no IFMAR champion has started from, ever. The buggies have all cleared tack and are set to be released for the main final prep work. They will have exactly 60 minutes to work on their buggies for the final.
Yeah, track's a lot different. I had a really bad semi. No speed, no comfort. We'll see.
I think we found our tire. Ty's found his lines. His car looked really good, I thought. So I got high hopes, God willing, and we should be there.
Confidently nervous. Trust my guys.
Yeah, of course. If you're not nervous, then you don't care.
I'm just clicking a stopwatch and putting fuel in it, which I could ruin the whole race, but no, I'm not nervous.
Fastest. And he fights clean.
down and quiet. And we're off.
The 12 best drivers at these Las Vegas Worlds have been decided. 2 years of racing, testing, and preparation have come down to the next 60 minutes of racing. It almost seems unfair. The crowd is anxious for the start of the race, and they are growing restless as there is a delay on the track. Cavallari has flamed out on the grid. He is refired, but he must start from pit lane. This will drop him from second starting spot all the way down to 12th. Did this flameout just cost Ryan Cavallari a world championship?
All right, here we go, here we go, here we go. Marshals ready. Drivers ready. 3, 2, 1, down and quiet.
Tessman leads the first lap, and thanks to the empty number two starting spot that should have been filled with Cavallari, he has built up a small lead over second place, David Ronnefalk. With only one other nighttime run to draw from, the Tessmans opted to switch tread patterns in favor of a faster car in wet conditions. Even though they won the semifinals on regular fugitive, they have decided to run the light edition for the final. So far, Ty's car looks fast, and he is holding Ronnefalk at bay. Perhaps this was the right call, but the track looks very dry. Top qualifier Jared Thibault, hoping his struggles would have ended with the semis, was in for a long race.
You know, semi was terrible, but after the semi, I mean, I didn't even want to drive, so the semi was just disastrous. So, 45 down, 48, 15 to go. Made some changes, made a tire change. Tire change was great. You know, I probably shouldn't have changed the setup change I did. I was really happy with my start. Battled really hard at the beginning, just got out of my rhythm there for about 10 minutes in the middle of the race and lost a ton of track time. And, you know, kind of latched on to David when he started to lap me, and then he crashed and I got in front of him and, you know, kind of drove away from him when he started making the mistakes. And I think I was in eighth maybe, and, you know, moved up to fourth and was really catching that battle for a second. I just, you know, kind of wrecked it for myself there in the middle of the race. So
after dominating qualifying, the last thing Jared wants to be is battling for fourth. But that's exactly what he is doing.
But Cavallari going to try to recover from having to start in pit lane. But he's got plenty of time to do it.
Cav is pressing. He is all over Thibault. He pushes just a bit too hard, and he bobbles, allowing Thibault to pull away. This would be as close as the battle for fourth would get. The first cycle of pit stops begins. Boots is in and out with a fabulous stop. While Elliott was the fastest driver currently on track, he too chose the wrong tread pattern, and his buggy, with each passing lap, becomes harder and harder to drive. He would finish down in the 10th spot. Up front, Tessman still leads Ronnefalk. David pits, and even though Ty would have had time to come in with David, he opts to stay out. This would be a very costly mistake. With no one to push him on the track for this single lap, Ty's pace drops. Even with an amazing pit stop the next lap, it's not enough to get out in front of David, who takes over the lead.
We have the battle for third as well between Mayfield and Tebow. So David Ronnefalk, Ty Testman, won the world championship, only 9 minutes left to go.
Now Ty is doing the chasing, and he is slowly losing touch with Ronnefalk. Lap after lap, David inches away from his teammate. Due to less than anticipated moisture levels, the track is much more abrasive than we have seen it.
The car was good. I think I just picked the wrong tread pattern. Should have had the old fugitive, like I ran in the semi. I think it would have held up better, felt better. But we didn't really know what to do, so it was a gamble and didn't pay off.
As the race drags on, it becomes very clear the tread on Ty's tires was disappearing fast. His pace was dropping, and he was struggling to hold on to second place. Young Davide Ongaro was closing in on him, with Robert Battier in tow. It's becoming clear that Ty is in the fight of his life, not to win these worlds, but simply to remain on the podium. Up front, it was still David Ronnefalk. Pierre, his father, watched anxiously in the pits as the final moments of these worlds ticked down. David would hold on to become the 16th 8-scale off-road champion of the world.
I mean, I can't, there's so many to thank Adrian for everything, my family, my girlfriend, my sister for making the great videos this week for me. I just want to thank, big huge thanks to everybody, and this is with you guys.
Only other competitor that matched David's elation was Robert Battier, who finished second.
Just amazing. From hospital I have been on Tuesday to here, it's amazing.
Like, how's your kidney stone?
Still here. She's my friend now.
You can't always have the Cinderella ending like you want, and that's part of racing. You know, I'll go home happy tomorrow and see my family, and have a new baby boy coming in a couple weeks, so excited for that. Got a big list of honeydews when I get home, bunch of housework, so woohoo!
Well, we've got two more Euros before the next Worlds. Got British Championships to win, bigger race, international races, you know, there's always races to go. We've always got to keep fighting and, you know, keep pressing on and do the best we can for our sponsors and for ourselves.
Pretty disappointed, but did everything I could, so I can't really get upset about anything. Working in for another 2 years to Australia and try again.
He drove amazing. He did everything he could. Very proud of him. But it's not a win. So we'll come back, fight the next 2 years from now. See what we can do.
Both Gord and Ty took the loss very hard. At the top level of this sport, with so much at stake, it is completely expected. Shortly after the Worlds, we would find out that this was an end of an era for the Testmans.
Sponsors are Hot Bodies, Trinity, Temp Gun, Raceway Hobbies. Special thanks to my dad and Aaron Waldron and Team Losi. Let's hear it for Ty Testman.
After a 12-year partnership, this would be the last time we see Ty driving an HB Racing buggy. While Ty, only 23, will have many more chances at another IFMAR title, it would not be with Hot Bodies. The pits are deserted, the track is empty. The Vegas Worlds are over.
Yeah, we did the best we could. You know, David had some really good lines out there. He did a really good job, and you know, you can't take anything away from him for sure. So yeah, it's awesome, man. You win some, you lose some. I still think it was a great Worlds. You know, hey, we're moving on, man. We'll be in Australia in 2018, and we'll see what happens down under.
Never known to dwell on past failures or accomplishments for that matter, this cycle is about to repeat itself. Industry insiders are already preparing for the 2018 Worlds.